church is made up of imperfect people trusting in a perfect Savior, but God still calls us to honor one another. Today on Connect with Skip Heitzig, Skip shows you how Paul affirmed the sacrifice of Epaphroditus and how you can also encourage your brothers and sisters in the faith.
Your messenger means your ambassador, your delegate. The word apostolon, we get the word apostle from that, somebody set out on a task. So Epaphroditus volunteered to be the guy set out by the Philippians to make a 6-week, 800-mile journey to serve Paul, to be their messenger. There's something I'd like you to do. Next time a missionary comes to town, and we have our missionaries from the field come back during the year, they set up a kiosk often in the foyer. Sometimes we'll, on a Wednesday night, bring them up and pray for them and hear from them. Next time you see a missionary back home, would you mind going up to them and just give them a good word of encouragement? Thank them for going to the field on your behalf. You go, on my behalf? Yes, on your behalf. You're not there. You didn't go. I didn't go. So they are sent out by us, from us, and they're out there in very difficult situations, and it's always great when somebody acknowledges that they did that. You thank them for that. My dad was a fisherman, and he was into fishing, and he had his buddies, and he tried to get us into fishing, and it's like, whatever, I really wasn't into it, and sorry if you're a fisherman and you hear that, and I've disappointed you, perhaps. But when they would talk about fishing, they were just so into where they would go hunting or fishing, and if I were to ask, let's say you are a fisherman here, you're really good at it, if I were to ask you, okay, think of the best place you can think of in your mind right now, best place you've ever gone fishing. You probably won't say Shady Lakes over here. Although that's a great place for your family because they stock it full of fish. You can throw your little line in there and get fish any day of the week, but it's probably not your favorite. I'm going to hear something probably like this. Oh, man, I know this place, but it's so far away and it's hard to get to. And once you get there, you got to hike in and camp out. And it's kind of difficult and dangerous, but man, the fish are hungry. That's missions. That's missions. Willing to go to another difficult place because the fish are hungry there. So treat your ambassadors, your messengers, with respect and love. Well, there's a fifth that Paul mentions about Epaphroditus, and that is also in verse 25, the one who ministered to my need. Look at all five of them: brother, fellow worker, fellow soldier, your messenger, and the one who ministered to my need. Paul isn't just throwing that in. He's using a very particular term here for ministered to my need. The word he uses is the word liturgos. We get the word liturgy from that. It speaks about a sacred duty, like a priest would perform, a sacerdotal duty, a sacred duty of a priest. So what the Apostle Paul is doing with his friend and brother Epaphroditus is taking his service and elevating it to the performance of a sacred task. Now, I have a question for you. Have you done that with your occupation? Do you go to work and go, I hate my job. God, why do I have this job? Or do you go to the job and say, I am here by divine appointment. God called me to this, and I am embracing this as a calling of God to discover what people he wants me to reach. When I used to work in medicine and radiology, and I would share the gospel with people when there were breaks or we had time to have discussions, I remember one guy came up to me that I worked with, and he said, Skip, you ever think about getting out of this and getting into full-time ministry? And I remember I said to him, let me let you in on a little secret. I am in full-time ministry right now. He said, what do you mean? I said, well, I'm talking to you. I've invited you to church. You won't go to church, so I'm here right now talking to you. And I see this as my full-time ministry. And I love that Paul does that with Epaphroditus, takes his service, his ministry, and brings it up to the level of a sacred duty. Like the housewife who had a sign above her sink that read, "Divine service rendered here 3 times daily. She saw that as a calling from God to minister to her family, a sacred duty from the Lord. So, all said, learn to look at people through the lens of their strengths, of their attributes, of their beneficial qualities. Don't always notice their faults. Start noticing their strengths. Now, I have to say something. This won't come naturally for some of us. For some of us, we have been conditioned to be so negative that if you put us in a situation or we meet new people, we immediately go negative. We pick out all the faults, all the problems, all the reasons it can't be done, blah, blah, blah. So you need to be trained by God's grace, and hopefully this message will help a little bit, to start looking for positive traits, because you can find positive traits in the worst people. So there was a woman who always complimented everyone, and it drove her friend nuts. And one day her friend said, "You know, I think you would probably even compliment the devil." And she thought about that and said, "Well, you got to admit, he is persistent." So it can be done. And Paul did it. He acknowledged his strengths. Here's the second principle in treating good but imperfect people. Not only acknowledge their strengths, accept their shortcomings. Accept their shortcomings. Okay, let me tell you what's happening here, because you read it. Epaphroditus makes 800-mile journey, 6-week journey, comes to Rome. He gets sick. And the word is a very strong word. It's the same word used of Lazarus when he got sick and died. Paul says Epaphroditus almost died. So he comes and gets sick either on the journey or while he is in Rome. And Epaphroditus finds out that the Philippians found out that he was sick. So when they found out that he was sick, they got all distressed. Well, when Epaphroditus found out that they found out, and that when they found out, they got distressed. He's distressed because they're distressed. He's anxious because they're anxious. He's concerned because they're concerned. And so, watch this, verse 25. "Yet I considered it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus." Epaphroditus came from Philippi. He's sending him back to Philippi. Verse 26, "Since he was longing for you all and was distressed because you heard he was sick." Go down to verse 28. "Therefore, I sent him the more eagerly, that when you see him, you may rejoice and I may be less sorrowful." Okay, normally when a guy gets sick and gets better, you just write a letter and say, "He's better now. Don't worry yourselves. He's good. He's healthy. Everything's great." But what Paul does, he goes, "I'm writing this letter, and you, Epaphroditus, are taking it back. I'm sending you back. You stay back home." Why? Well, look at verse 26 just once more time. "He was longing for you all." The word means a deep, intense longing, a deep desire, a yearning for. So the New English Translation renders it, "He greatly missed all of you." Here's what I think is happening. I think that not only did Epaphroditus get physically sick, he has a bad case of homesickness as well. He's yearning for them. He misses them. He misses home. And now he hears that they're distressed, that he was distressed. He goes, "Oh," he's pining away. So Paul says, "You know, I found it necessary just to send him back home. I'm sending him back to you. He's coming back. Therefore, receive him." Now, I see this as Paul's gracious attitude in overlooking a young man's weakness. He's not making a big deal of it. He's honoring and building him up, but he's sending him back home. He's yearning for you. I'm sending him back home. Now, follow me here. I believe Paul the Apostle himself has grown in grace a little bit. What do I mean? Well, on his first missionary journey, Paul and Barnabas take a young man, Barnabas' nephew, named John Mark. John Mark gets homesick, runs back to Jerusalem. When they went to Pamphylia, he goes, I'm out of here, goes back home. So when the journey's done, and Paul says, you know, Barney, that's Barnabas, we ought to go back and visit all those places one more time and see all those people who made their decisions to follow Christ. And Barney goes, awesome, I'm going to take John Mark, my nephew, again. Paul goes, no, you're not. He left us the first trip. He flaked out one time. He is not going back with us again. Well, an argument broke out between Barney and Paul, and they went their separate ways. That was then. This is now. Now we have Epaphroditus, who was longing for you all. And Paul says, I'm sending him back home, but he does it very graciously. He makes it easier for Epaphroditus to go back home. He does not say, I'm sending Epaphroditus, the wimp, back to you, the weasel, so he can stay with you in Philippi, the guy who couldn't cut it. He's very gracious with him. He makes it easy for him to go back home.
Skip Heitzig met recently with best-selling author Joel Rosenberg, where they talked about current pressure in the epicenter.
On the one hand, Israel is the most endangered country in the world. Now, if you're about to try to get people to go on tour, I've got another part of that also. But let me just start by saying, you know, Iran wants to eliminate us, right? The term they use is they want to annihilate, wipe us off the map, right? And Hezbollah, the Iranian-backed, armed, supplied, trained, funded terror regime in southern Lebanon, they want to annihilate us, right? Hamas, in their charter, the terrorist group in Gaza, they want to annihilate and liquidate the Jewish people in the state of Israel. So, you know, there's not many countries in the world where there are active enemies that talk about the complete genocide of a people. And the elimination of a nation. So that's very targeted. You know, you think, why would you want to live there? Right? Well, so that's the one hand. On the other hand, Israel and Israelis are feeling more secure today than at any other time in human history. Most Jews are like, yeah, people hate us. We get it. We're Jewish. You know, have you seen all the movies throughout history where going back to, you know, Charlton Heston taking on Yul Brynner in the Ten Commandments. I mean, come on, people, yeah, they've hated us. Read the Bible, that's the story. But just because they hate us doesn't mean we're always in grave danger. We have the most powerful air force in the region. We have the most powerful ground force. We have missile defenses that actively shoot down the rockets, most of them, 90% of them, that are inbound.
That's the Iron Dome.
Iron Domes, David Sling, Patriot, the Arrow. It's a crisscrossing network of systems that can do just mortars and rockets, but also ICBMs.
Wow.
So we also have they're diesel submarines, but they're advanced state-of-the-art submarines that are parked right off the coast of Iran with missiles that can take out entire Iranian cities. These guys just live there under the water, just waiting for the moment, and then they switch with another. Like, we have, we have treaties now, peace treaties with Egypt. Egypt has been our main enemy for 4,000 years. But they're not now. Mm. And you and I have been to Egypt. We see what's going on. And the relationship between the Egyptian leadership and the Israeli leadership. Peace treaty with Jordan. My point is, we are both the most endangered country in the world, Israel is, and feeling more secure than ever in human history. That's a conundrum. Mm-hmm. It's the very conundrum that lays the groundwork for the prophecies of the war of Gog and Magog. But even if you don't go down that road, it's just an interesting moment. People who come on your tours,
they feel secure.
They have friends that say, why would you do that? Are you crazy? What are you, I mean, Skip's a nice guy, but I mean, come on, why don't you go to the Caribbean? And then they come back like, oh my gosh, that was so amazing. I never felt in danger. I want to live there.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? And you can hardly get them on the plane to come back. And so that's a conundrum. Yeah, but it's fun. It's an exciting moment. I mean, we had 100 rockets fired at us last week from Gaza.
Last week,
100. And yet we've got, last year we had 450 in 2 days during a 2-day period. 450 rockets fired at your country. And yet the last several years we've had record tourism every single year. There's not enough beds, and there's not enough hotels, there's not enough buses. People want to come, and they're not being thrown by these things. Conundrum.
There was a family, and the kids decided to give Dad for his birthday a genealogical record of his family history. He had always wanted to know who his relatives were in the past, where he had come from. So the kids got together and said, let's give that gift to Dad. They hired a biographer to look in the records and find out the different family tree. Well, the biographer came to the family, got the kids aside and said, well, we have a problem. It seems that in your family history, there's this Uncle George who down in Alabama killed somebody, he's a murderer, and he was sentenced to death by the electric chair. And they thought, oh man, that's a blot on our family record. That's the black sheep of the family. We don't want that in there. At the same time, that's part of our history. You have to write about it. So they said, just go ahead and include it. Well, when the biographer was done and presented the journal of the family records, they were delighted in the way he treated Uncle George. He put it this way. Uncle George occupied a chair of electronics at an important government institution. He was attached to his position with the strongest of ties, and his death came as a real shock. Come on, you gotta hand it to the biographer for adding a little finesse and grace to the story of Uncle George, making the truth a little easier. Now, you remember that Paul the Apostle calls the church by the title the body of Christ. And he said the church is like a human body. There are parts of it that are noticeable. There are parts of it that you don't see but are very vital. And so he writes this, 1 Corinthians 12, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And those parts that we think are less honorable, we treat with special honor. See, everybody has strengths. And everybody has weaknesses. Everybody has assets. Everybody has deficits. Everyone is gifted in some area. Everyone is not gifted in other areas. But friendship flourishes at the fountain of forgiveness. And when you can overlook certain people's faults and foibles, it goes a long way. That's how you treat good but imperfect people. Acknowledge their strengths and accept their shortcomings. Let me give you a, please, go ahead, I'll let you respond, sorry. Let me give you a third and we'll close. Affirm their sacrifice. Now watch verse 27. Paul says, for indeed, or really man, he was sick almost unto death, but God had mercy on him and not only on him, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. Verse 29, receive him therefore in the Lord with all gladness and hold such men in esteem. For because of the work of Christ, he came close to death, not regarding his life to supply what was lacking in your service toward me. Now consider something for a moment. Paul, the apostle, says, I got a guy here with me who's working with me who got really, really, really sick. And he almost died. Really? A guy with Paul got sick? Paul the apostle, the one who moved in the miraculous, Paul the apostle, the one the Bible says had sweatbands taken from him, laid on sick people, and they got better? How do you get somebody with Paul who's sick? Because Christians get sick. Don't ever think, well, if you're a child of God and you have faith in Jesus, you just get snapped on the forehead, hallelujah, and you're healed. That's just weird. Epaphroditus got sick and he almost died, Paul said. He admitted it. And it wasn't just Epaphroditus. There was Timothy that Paul writes a letter to and says, hey, I know you have a stomach problem. Take some wine for it. which was in antiquity, medicine. Take some medicine for your stomach, not come to a healing service. If you have enough faith, you'll be healed. Just take medicine. So you got Epaphroditus and Timothy, both got sick. Not only that, but Trophimus the Ephesian, it says in 2 Timothy chapter 4, Paul says, I left him at Miletus sick. So not only was he sick, Paul left him sick and walked away. So not only Timothy, not only Epaphroditus, not only Trophimus, but even Paul got sick. Paul talked about a thorn in the flesh, 2 Corinthians 12, an adversity, an infirmity that he had. He said, I prayed 3 times that the Lord would remove it. Effectively, God said no, because he said, my grace is all you need. And so he said, I will then glory in my infirmity. I'll glory in my sickness. I won't glory only if I'm healed of it. But godly people can get sick too. It doesn't mean you lack faith. Now, I will say I do not understand physical healing. I love when it happens. But if you ask me to give you a formula, I can't. And if you say, well, you ought to say just have enough faith and you'll be healed, I won't, because that's not biblical. I prayed for people and I've watched them get healed before my eyes on some occasions. I prayed for other people and they got worse and died on other occasions. So this is what I know. God does want our faith and does engender our faith, but healing is according to God's sovereign plan and purpose, period. So he was sick, and he affirms that this guy sacrificed almost to the point of death. So verse 30, look at it. For the work of Christ, he came close to death, not regarding his life. The two words not regarding is a word, parabolumenai. Don't expect you to ever remember that word. It's a Greek word that means to throw the dice, to gamble, to bet on, to put all of the chances upon. He's saying Epaphroditus placed his very life in danger, risking it all, putting all of his chances on God. You might say a gambler for God. And he made it all the way from Philippi to Rome, got sick, I'm sending him home, but you got to affirm that he made a sacrifice. And so Paul says, therefore, receive him, verse 29, in the Lord with all gladness. Receive him like Jesus would receive him. And he says, hold such men in esteem, those servants who sacrifice for the gospel. Respect them, admire them. 1 Thessalonians 5, Paul said, respect those who work hard among you, who are over you in the Lord and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard in love because of their work. We have a little saying around here that we teach our staff about honor. It goes like this, honor up, honor down, honor all around. So we want those above you to be honored, your supervisors, your bosses, the one who cast the vision, the one who hire you, you honor them. You honor spiritual leaders, but you also honor down. You don't say, I'm to be honored. You go, no, how can I honor and serve you? Those that you give directions to, those who help out in a variety of ways, you honor them. You affirm them. Honor up, honor down, honor all around. A guest speaker, honor the guest speaker. A guest musician, honor the guest musician. Because it's so easy to overlook those who serve. Ushers, those who take care of your kids in the Sunday school room, people who smile at the doors and walk you from the parking lot and the VIP treatment, the security, thank them. Don't cop an attitude. No, you can't look at my backpack. None of your business. Yes, it is when you bring a backpack into a group of people where you could hide something dangerous in it. May I please see it? Don't cop an attitude. Thank them. Honor them. Affirm their sacrifice. Listen, a pat on the back, though only a few vertebrae removed from a kick in the pants, is miles ahead in results. A few more pats on the back for these volunteers, not kicks in the pants. So learn to be a servant. Learn to bless a servant. And let me just end by saying to you, no matter if you're a lion or a golden retriever or an otter or a hardworking beaver. On behalf of heaven, thank you. Thank you for serving God and serving God's people and being willing to take time and give to them and help us all grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus.
As the body of Christ, it's important to treat one another well, regardless of our shortcomings. Right now, we want to tell you about a resource that will help you discover Jesus' plan for redemption through every page of Scripture. More than 26 million people have sampled their own DNA using an at-home testing kit. People's interest in discovering their ancestry and building their family tree has skyrocketed. When we're born again, we get an entirely new and divine DNA. We're adopted by God into His family. Discover how the story of redemption is part of your history and your future in Bloodline. This journey through Scripture traces the DNA of redemption, and it's our thanks to you when you give to this ministry. Connect with Skip Heitzig is a presentation of Connection Communications, connecting you to God's never-changing truth in ever-changing times.